We begin in the name of the God whose mercy is profound, whose kindness is forever. In this Why Islam series, I am now talking about the sources of knowledge that are employed to understand Islam and its teachings. I talked about the Quran in the last presentation, and towards the end, I mentioned the fact that the Quran has definite coherence in the manner it has been arranged in its present form. The coherence that is found in the Quran has been described by an author as thematic and structural coherence in the Quran. In other words, there is coherence in the Quran both in the themes of the surahs as well as the manner it has been structured, the entire Quran, the way it has been designed. I also mentioned the fact that this coherence is found at three levels. It is found at the level of surahs, it is found at the level of surah pairs, and it is also found at the level of surah groups. So let's take surah unit as the first item. All 114 surahs of the Quran have been arranged and designed in a manner that they all have their own respective central themes. And the verses, the passages that are found in each surah, are serving those themes in a manner that if you understand the entire presentation of the surah, you would find that each verse is making its definite contribution. In order for this understanding to emerge clearly for the reader, the leader has to either himself or herself divide each surah, the larger ones, into different paragraphs, and then join those paragraphs together by understanding the underlying binding themes, ideas that have caused them to be put together the way they are sequenced now. It's a long subject, but I'll just attempt to give an example. The example of surah number 62. It's called Suratul Jum'ah. It has 11 verses, and as I said, the surah has to be divided into paragraphs. Either you do it yourself or some expert scholar will do it for you. But in the case of Surah Al-Jum'ah, it's not a difficult task to find out that it is naturally divided into three paragraphs. It has the first four verses, followed by fifth verse till the eighth one, and then the ninth verse till the 11th is the third paragraph. The first paragraph mentions the fact that the Almighty has been extremely kind to the unlettered people of the Arabian Peninsula, where the children of Ishmael are living, and they have been given God's message. God's messenger has been appointed, who belongs to these people, who is from amongst them. This is a great blessing, and the Almighty has mentioned it to ask the people who belong to that group to take this blessing of the Almighty seriously and to value it. The next paragraph all of a sudden shifts to another theme, and that's what the challenge in understanding the Quran, its different surahs, is. That there seem to be apparently sudden shifts. The next paragraph is talking about the Jews, the children of Israel, who were given a similar gift by the Almighty in the form of a book, Torah, which in many cases they did not take seriously. They were not aware of the significance of the Almighty's bounty, blessing that was given to them. And their example turned out to be the example of a donkey on whose back there were loads of books, and the poor animal was unaware of what load it was taking. The passage goes on to mention the fact that these people who claim to be believers in God and His message, they have become so obsessed with the worldly life that they don't want to leave it. And yet they claim that they are favorites of the Almighty. The Almighty says that they would never ever wish to die because they know what they have done for the future. Their misdeeds make them fearful of the prospects of death, even though death is a reality that is going to overtake everyone. And then everyone is going to be taken to the Almighty, who is fully aware and knowledgeable of what is hidden and what is manifest. A little careful reflection would give an understanding to the reader that the first passage and the second passage, even though talking about two different themes, are linked with each other. In that, while in the first passage the Almighty is describing His blessings to the people of the Arabian Peninsula, the children of Ishmael, in the second passage, the example of a group of people who were given a similar gift by the Almighty and them not taking it seriously has been given for the people of the Arabian Peninsula, the children of Ishmael, to take a lesson from it. The third paragraph is more tricky, wherein in the last three verses, the Almighty is talking about the fact that Muslims, believers, have to take the Jummah prayer seriously. The call for the Friday prayer is given. Whenever it is done, Muslims have to leave everything that they are doing and reach out for the masjid where God's message is read out and prayer is held. And the Quran also mentions the fact that there are some people amongst Muslims who are not taking it seriously and warns them of consequences if they are going to continue doing likewise, and mentions the fact that God has all the resources, all the blessings at his disposal. So they should better focus on God's message and remembering Him rather than to be diverted and distracted towards worldly engagements. This third passage is linked with the rest of the two in that the Jews did not take the expectation of the Almighty to abide by the law of Sabbath, the expectation for them to worship the Almighty on Saturday and do nothing else. They did not take it seriously, and that caused their downfall, moral, spiritual downfall. The Almighty is as if telling Muslims, believers, the children of Ishmael, that they should stay away from doing likewise. The second level of coherence is the level of surah pairs. The Quran has 114 chapters, surahs, out of which 6 are unique surahs. The rest, 108 surahs, have been divided into 54 pairs, such that in each pair, there are two partners pairing up, and they are talking about the same one central theme in such a way that one of them is talking about dealing with one aspect of that theme and the other is dealing with another aspect of that theme, and yet they have quite a few commonalities which put together make them a pair. One example is the Second and the third surahs, chapters of the Quran, Al-Baqarah and Al-Imran, both are Madanan surahs. Both begin with the disjointed letters Huruf Muqattaat, Alif Lam Mim, and both end with prayer to the Almighty. A believer is asking for his help, for God's attention. When we look at the contents of the two surahs, we find that both surahs, which are pretty long surahs, they have been divided into two parts. The first part is inviting the people of the book to have faith in God's message, to accept this message as coming from God. The second part of both surahs is inviting the believers, the Muslims, to take God's message seriously and to get attached to it in a proper way. However, in the case of Al-Baqarah, the second surah of the Quran, the first half, when it invites the people of the book, it invites the Jews among them, the children of Israel more particularly. And in the next surah, Surah Al-Imran, even though both groups of people of the book are invited, the invitation extended to the Christians, the Nazarenes, is more prominent. When we look at the second parts of both surahs, we find that even though both of them are asking Muslims, believers in the Quran and the Prophet, may God's mercy be on him, to take the Almighty's message seriously, in Al-Baqarah, in the second half, the Almighty has given a number of injunctions of Sharia which were needed at the time when the surah was being revealed for them to be followed. But in the case of the third surah, Ali Imran, in the second half, when the Muslims have been addressed, we find that there is no injunction of Sharia mentioned. All that we find is that with the Battle of Uhud in the background, the Almighty is guiding believers and letting them know as to why things happened the way they happen in the Battle of Uhud. In other words, it is like a certain event has taken place and the example of that event has been employed in the surah for the Muslims to be guided in the light of what happened, the way it is normally done in case study methods, which is employed in many business schools. The third level of coherence is the level of surah groups. The Quran has been neatly divided into seven surah groups in a way that each group has one or more Meccan surahs at the beginning, and each surah ends with one or more Madinan surahs. So we have seven surah groups which have Meccan and Madinan surahs, which are talking about one particular broad theme which runs through the entire surah group. We find that the sequence of these surahs has been arranged in a manner that the order is chronological within the surah group. I'll take just one surah group and briefly give an understanding as to how this group put together forms one coherent presentation. The group is the second group, which is comprised of four surahs, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Surah Al-An'am, Surah Al-A'raf, Surah Al-Anfal, and Surah At-Tawbah. The first two of these surahs are Meccan surahs, and the next two surahs are Madinan surahs. The Meccan surahs are forming a pair, and the Madanan Suras are forming a pair. The central theme of this group is the actualization of the promise that the Almighty had made that God's messenger and his followers are going to dominate and prevail, because those who were the adversaries, who had opposed the message, they had become eligible to be punished by the Almighty. So the punishment of the Almighty that some nations received because they were visited by God's messengers, his Rasul, this decision of the Almighty to annihilate the addressees of the messengers, it was implemented for the last time in the case of the last messenger, Muhammad, God's mercy be on him. And this entire process has been described in the second group of surahs. So the first surah, Surah Al-An'am, invites the people of the Arabian Peninsula in general and the people of Mecca in particular to have faith in the book that has been revealed and the messenger who has brought the book, or the book has been revealed on him. The second surah, Araf, is a book of warning. It warns the same people who were invited in the earlier surah to have faith. It warns them of dire consequences if they are going to continue to insist on rejecting the message, and informs them about many earlier nations who, when they rejected the message of the messengers of God, were destroyed by one punishment or another. Surah Al-Anfal is the surah of preparation. The Almighty inflicts his punishments on the nations who are visited by the messengers, either in the form of natural calamities or in the form of the military might of the followers of the messenger. In the case of the last messenger, may God's mercy be on him, it was the second possibility that was availed, because the number of followers of the messenger was large. So they were prepared both spiritually, morally, and militarily in the 8th chapter, Surah Anfal. The 9th chapter, the 9th surah, is a surah of punishment. All those people who rejected the message of the messenger have actually been subjected to punishment in this particular surah. Therefore, it is the only surah of the Quran which is not preceded by the usual customary expression, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, a verse which means that we begin in the name of the God whose mercy is profound, whose kindness is forever. Because in this particular surah, the Almighty mentions punishments that were meted out to those who rejected the message of the Almighty. Because those who rejected the message of the Almighty belong to three different groups, their fate has been described in this surah, one after the other, in three different passages. In the first 28 verses, the Almighty is talking about the punishment that was given to the polytheists of the Arabian Peninsula, for whom, after the deadline was reached, announced by the Almighty, they were to be killed. The second passage, which begins from verse 29 and lasts for some 5-6 verses, the punishment inflicted upon the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians, has been mentioned. They were to be fought against and were to be forced to subjugate and live as second-rate citizens in the Arabian Peninsula. And finally, the punishment inflicted on the hypocrites, who were the third category of rejecters of the message, that has been mentioned, and their hypocrisy has been exposed. So you see, this group is comprised of 4 chapters, surahs, and each surah is playing its own important respective role: invitation, warning, preparation, and punishment.